ghetto. Yeah. We were gonna have a cockroach on the table. We found one over here, but then
put out the cockroach.
Put it in your teeth.
It'll give it. It'll definitely like, you know, some ambiance.
Okay. All right. Whenever you're ready, Pat. All right. I guess we're on. I'll wait for you.
I just used a little machine there. No, it's a birth control pill. It says directions.
What?
Female should place pill on inside of right knee and hold in place with left knee, applying steady pressure. This method of birth control provides guaranteed results with no side effects. In other words, close your legs.
All right.
We're ready for love tonight, baby.
How do you open this damn thing, man? Don't even have any opening instructions. Do not open until, okay. Yeah, until you want to use it. Man, what the hell?
I won't be opening that for a long time.
Yeah, what the damn.
Quick, open it.
I know, man. I want to see what this birth control pill is.
So
I'm curious about this. Place on the inside of right knee and hold with the left knee.
Just dumb.
Yeah, this is a birth control pill for a moron. No!
Kick ass.
Wow.
What's that mean?
It's a piece of candy, a BCP.
Is that who made it? Birth control.
Birth control pill.
God, we're fucking old.
Is this the
smoking too much crack here?
Yeah, it's just, it doesn't taste like sugar.
Come on, save it. Oh, come on, save it.
It's one of those Valentine's.
Doesn't things. Taste like babies. Oh, well.
All right.
All right, that's my excitement for the day.
All right, cool. All right, hey everybody, what's going on here? You're on another edition of The Dark Hour. I'm, of course, Paul, your host, and we're here with Matt from Nothingface.
Hello.
So, can you introduce yourself? Well, we know who you are, but what do you do in the band? Get another one. That one's kind of wet.
I sing. I jump around, yell and scream, and generally cause a commotion, you know.
Cool. All right. Now, it's been hard for me to describe your guys' kind of music to viewers as a host. You just like getting them all wet, huh? So if you had to describe your music to somebody, like how would you describe the kind of music that you guys play?
Heavy metal, with a little bit of melody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's so hard. I could sit here and classify the music and come with all the stupid long, you know, meaningful reason of what my band sounds like and la la la. But that's crap. When it comes down to it, when you ask a 14-year-old kid what my band sounds like, he's gonna be heavy metal. You know, we're heavy, we're aggressive, we're angry, we're pissed off. That's metal, you know, and I guess I sing about almost half the time, and this is a metal band with metal melody.
Okay.
So.
Okay. All right. How did you guys all hook up then?
Well, basically, I was in actually another band at the time. The three of them had been playing together, and my bass player had a studio, Bill, our current bass player, and my band was going there and recording, and I got to know the guys really, really, really well over time. They didn't have a singer. And I finally bugged them to the point where they let me audition. You know, because I kind of looked up to Nothingface at the time. They were, you know, not one of the bigger local bands, but they were definitely a local band that you watched them and you knew something about them. But I'd watch them and always go, man, the music's great, but the vocals suck. And the band I was in was a bunch of younger guys that around my age at the time, who really were caught up more in the idea of being in a band and hanging out with chicks and stuff like that than actually writing good music. And you know, through bugging the shit out of the three guys in my band, they let me come and join, and here we are 3 years later. But the way they got together was my drummer had placed an ad and found Tom, our guitar player, but he'd been playing with Bill, our bass player, for, Jesus, at this point, like 15 years.
Yeah.
They've known each other since, you know, real, real little. So.
Okay. All right. Let's go back a couple years. How did you guys get hooked up with Burton and then D-Side Records?
Mark Thorpe, who does A&R at D-Side, he came to see us at a club called the University Concert Hall, and shortly after that, you know, actually they were talking to us about signing. We were just kind of like, yeah, whatever. You're not Warner Brothers, so you can go to hell. And after a while, they showed us what they had to offer, what their ideas were, and they started off by asking us to be at a compilation. We did that. And we would talk more and more and more, and we finally realized that they were really legit, really professional, and really, really wanted this as bad as we did. So we're like, yeah, we'll go do this, you know. And the whole thing about signing to D-Side has always been to move on to something bigger after a amount of time, you know, because D-Side is a very small label. And You know, I think that'll end up happening soon. You know, but the guys at D-Side, we have the world to thank for. I mean, they put us out there in front of people, done an excellent job with it. And I mean, especially with the first band they ever put out. And, you know, I mean, we have to, if we end up getting, you know, growing as a band and getting to be one of the bigger bands, you know, we have them to thank first for just putting our shit out. Because we couldn't find anyone to release any of our albums before they came along. So I love those guys to death, and I'll kill for them because what they've done for me.
Cool. All right, well, let's check out a video, your first video, Pacifier. We'll be right back.
All right.
I hate that fucking video.
I got to tell you, that was a small story. When Bert called me, he sent me the video. He called me and he's like, yeah, what do you think? I'm like, you know, the music's kick-ass, but no offense to you, but it was your fucking outfit, man. I'm like, that dude, no offense.
No, dude.
You can punch me.
That wasn't my idea. Okay, like we wanted, you know, we're sitting there, we're gonna be all dark and evil. Like, mm-hmm. That's Nothingface. So they used a few of our ideas. And in case you couldn't tell which ones they were, you can't see what they are, but four of our friends are hung upside down, wrapped in trash bags and duct tape.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it just looked really cool. Like, yeah. When they were sitting there hanging there, we're like, that's great. And then the people doing the video wanted to have like a happier feel. So like, wear this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, wear. What are you talking about? I should have worn a black t-shirt. Basically dressed like this.
Yeah.
Like, nah. And the hair was an accident. I never would have done my hair like that. I was cutting my hair one day. Literally, what I was going to do was, the portions that were long, then we're going to be dressed. And everything was supposed to be like this long. But the guard fell off the clippers.
Ooh. Sounds like your friend's story.
Huge, horrible experience.
Jesus.
So yeah, I mean, actually, to top it all off, the security guard working on the video was the security guard that caught me smoking weed in high school.
Oops.
What are the chances of me ever running into that? And I run into him on my first video.
Mm-hmm.
Shit.
Oh.
No, I was kind of like, what are you doing here? Staying out of trouble?
No.
Sitting there, got a joint in my pocket.
No.
Yeah. But that's why all our videos are live videos now. It's good, really, because I will not do that again. I'm like,
When he sent the face, I was like, all right.
Yeah, that's a little bit better.
Yeah. All right. All right, everybody, what's going on? We're still here with Matt from Nothingface. Now that we've seen your video and we kind of get an idea of what you look and sound like, let's talk about, except for the clothes.
Everything in that last video was a complete accident. And if my band knew, I said that they'd all kill me, but oh well. So
let's talk about your first album. It was released on D-Side and rode CMJ, which is kind of like a Billboard thing. It rode the CMJ's Loud chart for 23 weeks. That's what I was told. So, I don't know, can you tell us about that? Like, what did you guys, how did that feel to you guys to be pretty much a new band, you know, riding a CMJ's chart?
I mean, it's kind of strange. I mean, you don't really know what to say about it when it's actually happening. You just kind of look at it and you're like, wow. You know, I mean, it's not something that, it's one of those things like you think about and you think about and you think about, and when it happens to you, you know, there's so many other emotions that are involved. It's kind of like you're almost reactionless. It's kind of like, that's cool. Mm-hmm. But after a while, you're like looking at it, you're like, okay, does it say number one yet?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you start caring about after a little while. I mean, but I'm 21 years old, and when I first saw ourselves on the charts in CMJ, I was 18, and that was, I was running around with the damn thing. I had it framed. I have it on my wall in my room. You know, like number 11. Yeah, not number one, 11. You know,
right,
yeah. So all framed, and when we were up, we stayed at number two forever this time around. And I got that one framed too. I mean, I can't say enough good things about it. I mean, it's kind of hard.
Yeah.
But
all
right. It's like, people like my stuff. Amazing.
Yeah, that's cool. Right now, you guys are on tour with Stuck Mojo. How's that been for you guys so far, and what's the crowds and the response been for you guys?
Well, this is the second time we toured with Mojo, actually. The first time was on during the Pacifier album, and those guys are some of our very, very best friends. In my opinion, they're the best band we have ever played with. You know, they're the most consistent live band I've ever seen in my life.
Mm-hmm.
They're the only band we've ever played with that there are other bands, I'm not going to name names, where you do a couple shows with them, and some nights they smoke, and other nights are just ooh.
Mm-hmm.
And Mojo, every single night, is really good. Even when I know they don't want to play, I'll be sitting there talking to Bones, he's like, man, I'm not feeling this today. Mm-hmm. They still go up there and they rip. You know, and they're one of those bands that has never been given the respect that they deserve, and I really, really, really hope one day that they get it.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, crowd-wise, the crowds have been awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in some places, you know, it's all Mojo's crowd, and the Mojo crowds have been great to us, and the shows, and there are a lot of other shows where we draw a lot of kids too, and you know, this has been the best tour I think I've ever been on. I mean, you know, the clubs haven't been the biggest clubs in the world at some of the times, and sometimes have been really shitty, but the shows have been amazing. Yeah. So.
Alright. Since your debut, you've now been licensed to Mayhem through D-Side. How has that changed your availability to the fans and album sales and other stuff?
Alright, get ready, because I'm about to trash Mayhem. Mayhem is useless.
Really?
We had nothing to do with that at all. That was purely Burton's thing. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, purely D-Side's thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when we started working with them, from what I understand, they were supposed to be taking care of our distribution and our marketing. You know, we signed a label, half the damn label leaves, you know, and they're leaves us with basically nothing. And, you know, you see other Mayhem bands like Boiler, for instance, and Cradle Filth, you know, and Crowbar, where you can find their albums everywhere, you know. We still have the same label on the back of our album and the same distribution company and the same people at Mayhem that are working it, and you can't find it anywhere. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they didn't do shit for us, you know. I mean, yeah, especially like, nowadays, a lot of the bands that make it, they play 4 or 5 shows, get signed, they're on a tour bus, mm-hmm. you know, because of the amount of friends they have. And you have bands like us, you have bands like Stuck Mojo, mm-hmm. you have bands like, I don't know if you've heard of Sam Black Church before from Boston, mm-hmm. Kilgore, yeah. You know? I mean, we're all bands that started out from the fucking, the bottom of the barrel, with no friends, didn't know anyone in the music industry, and have toured constantly in order to get noticed and seen, you know? And, it's really just flat out fucking irritating when you see bands that aren't as good as the band you're in. And I'm not trying to sound cocky, but I don't think we're the best band in the world, but I do think we're a really good heavy band, you know. And we see all these other crappy bands surpassing us just because they, oh, my friend so and so from so and so, and that's how you got your deal. And you're not talented like Ozfest. You know, Ozfest is a great tour to get on for a beginning band, but if you don't know someone real well connecting with Sharon or Osbourne, you don't get on it, you know. And and for us in our situation, the reason why we're not on Ozfest this time around is because our albums aren't in stores.
Right.
You know, people can't find our albums, and you know, everyone at the Ozfest, Sharon Osbourne loves our band, you know, but it until we move labels, it'd be a waste of time for us to do something like that, because we're going to playing for all these people, they're all going to see us, they're all going to love us, we're going to love what we're doing. But then when it comes down to looking at the numbers and stuff like that, when that really matters to your career, you know, you get a million kids coming to you going, oh man, I can't find your disc, mm-hmm. you know. So I mean, to the guys out there, if you want to find our album, please go to every record store you can, mainly Tower, and force them to start ordering it, because if the retail stores start ordering it from the distribution company, then they'll start ordering our album more often. So please, you know, please, 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 please. Been dreaming about this since I was 9 years old, and I'm this close, so.
That's cool. All right. Let's talk about the new album now. When was Everyday Guide released, and how is it doing in sales so far? I know with Mayhem you're saying
yeah.
It sucks.
Well, it's doing a lot better than it probably should, considering, you know, what's going on. But we've been really lucky that the fans we have are completely obsessed with us. But what do you want to know about Atrocity also?
When was it released?
September 19th. I'm not really sure how many albums we were selling a week. I know at one point we were selling like 2,000 albums a week, which was our highest point. I mean, things were going well. I mean, if you could read, but at the same time, it's still, I got every kid in the club coming up to me, I can't find your stuff. And most of our albums are being sold off the internet. But yeah, it came out the 19th of September. We've been on the road ever since. And, you know, I think it's doing all right, considering for what the position that we're in right now, like, you know, with us being on a small record label and stuff.
Well, compare and contrast your debut to your latest release. Which one are you happier with, and which one captures like the true vibe of Nothingface, if you were to capture it?
Well, a lot of the songs on Pacifier were earlier songs we had written together, and we really hadn't found ourselves, our identity as a band, yet at all. You know, we kind of knew what we wanted to do. We had a goal set, but not like we hadn't, you know, meshed a sound together. You can't really find your sound by talking about it. You just keep writing and writing and writing, so you hit a niche where everything you write is just you love, you know. And Pacifier, there's a lot of songs on there where I was still trying to figure out where I was going as a vocalist. I was still trying to learn how to be a singer and learn how to be a front man, and we were still trying to learn how to be, you know, a professional band. And you know, Pacifier is I think definitely shows that in us. But Atrocity is us, after being on the road forever, hanging around bigger bands, learning, you know, from our surroundings, and really getting a lot of confidence. And I love Atrocity. I still listen. It's still in my CD changer since the CDR that I got from the studio has not left my CD changer in my car since I got it. And you know, people can think whatever they want of this, but it's my favorite thing to listen to, and not so much because it's me. It's because I really genuinely love the music. And I mean, yeah.
All right. Well, since we're on the subject of the new album, let's check out your brand new video for Breathe Out, and we'll be right back with some more Nothing Face.
Turn.
Put your bitch in.
We have a fucking tripod. I just didn't
want to
drink
because
the pain
in
the ass is huge.
My answers are too long and drawn out.
No, because fucking, if you don't talk at all and you're like, yeah, it's cool, and you're fucking gay.
Yeah.
You know, you really. So.
This is water?
Yeah, water. Okay, no, I'd rather have you talk, otherwise, you know, what's the point of doing an interview if you're just like,
yeah,
I've done those interviews. They suck.
Yeah.
You know, they're shitty to watch, so, yeah. No,
totally.
It's awesome. Thank you. I tell you. If you suck, I tell you.
Yeah, I got that from Boston earlier. Close to your show, man. Me and Burton, I got the video that I got over to sell him back, Kind Bud. Not, I was sell drugs, but, like, I was getting it for him. Because him and I are both, like, big potheads. You ever met Burton?
No.
Like, there's nothing like you'll ever expect. I'm just telling you right now. Like, Burton is the closest thing to a serial killer I think I'd ever met. Like, a Ted Bundy kind of serial killer. Like, real rich, very, 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 very strange. You know, he's in his mid-20s. I mean, yeah. He's a billionaire, you know.
Can I have some money?
Owns all of MC Escher's originals. You know.
Wow.
Yeah, his grandfather started cable on the East Coast. And was also the governor of North Carolina for years. You know, and the guy, he's got a screw loose. You know, he's just very, very strange.
He's totally professional, though. I mean, when I'm emailing him or whatever, and when I talk to him,
he's schooled out the yin yang. I mean, he's, you know, and that's why I think it's so strange why he chose to do what he did, what he does now. But we just got your video. We're sitting there taking bongs, watching, just laughing the entire time.
Which episode did you see?
I don't know. It was a bunch of them.
Yeah, no, what one did you send them?
Six or eight, I don't know.
Yeah, we sat there and watched the whole thing.
Oh, God. It's all night.
Well, actually, I'm a huge Faith No More fan. You guys played The Surprise Your Day.
Yeah.
I've never seen that before. You know, freaking out. Hey, where are you that from?
Faith No More is one of my favorite bands.
Oh, man, I worship my cat. Anything he sings on, I like.
You like Mr. Bungle?
Yeah.
Man, he's a crazy motherfucker on that, isn't he?
No, I actually like the first Mr. Bungle album. Probably more than any of the Faith No More stuff, except for King for a Day, Fool for a Lifetime.
But like, yeah. I like Angel Dust the best.
That's good. Midnight Crisis is probably my favorite Faith No More song.
Oh, yeah. I remember getting drunk and singing that lots of times.
It's a good song. It's a good job. All right.
Look
at all that.
Fucking man, smoke is gone.
You don't smoke.
No, lick it.
All right.
All right, y'all, you're back, and it's a dark hour, and unless Paul has gotten 3 feet shorter, a little bit balder and fatter, nah. It's Pat, and I'm still here with what's-his-name from What's-His-Face.
Good.
All right. We'll get right back into it right away. I guess the people out there want to know who writes what. You know, how's that go?
You know, we all four of us come to the practice space with different riffs. You know, and we pretty much just sit there and scream at each other until we get a song done. Literally. I mean, we'll sit there and play every version of every riff we can until we're all like, fine, fine, fuck you, fine, fine. You know, and then there's the music, and I go back and write all the vocals and the lyrics and go in the studio.
How hard is it to find, like, an original riff? You know, like, all the music's been done before. I mean, how hard is it to go through, you know, like, this is cool, and then someone says, well, that was done by Metallica back in the 80s, you know?
Yeah, I've done that a couple times. You know, you just kind of get lucky, you know, and come on. I mean, really, the guitar is a limitless instrument, you know? Even though there's only 6 strings and 24 frets on a guitar, you can still come up with a million different things to do that no one's ever done before. And I don't know. I think our music's very original compared to a lot of the Southern California bands that are coming out now, you know. But I'd say it's pretty hard to come up with an original riff. But for us, it's more hard to come up with an original riff that wasn't written in the 80s, you know. I mean, like or early 90s. Like we don't have a problem with coming up with, like, I don't accidentally write a System of a Down riff or a Coal Chamber riff. I don't think I'll ever accidentally write a Coal Chamber riff. But
one question that I got is, I was reading your thank you list and everything, and it says, "Hail the Dragon Lord, his time approaches." What's that mean?
Bill, that's our bass player. We all have
stupid nicknames, you know, that we've used, and Bill will sit there and go home and write songs about it. And yeah, everyone calls Bill Dragon Lord, and it's just because he can do that heavy metal high pitch stuff really good, like straight up Rob Halford. It's awesome, almost as high as King Diamond at times. You know, yeah. Like the other night we're jamming out the Merciful Fate right on the street, you know, yeah, and that's why we call him Dragon. Like Tom, we call him T Player, just because you know he's always like, hey, you know, and call him Chris the Pissed, because he always reminds me of Ming the Merciless for some reason. Or a Sleestack, and they somehow started calling me Dr. Gorgeous. So not because of the way I look, just because I can do that like Barry White singing shit real good. So I sit there, like, you know, and I don't even know how we. Oh, the Dragon Lord thing. Well, yeah, Bill's the Dragon Lord.
Yeah, like Mahoney's one of them. Another dumb nicknames. I don't know where that came from. Anywho, what kind of music you listen to now, and what did you grow up listening to?
Well, the first band I ever really listened to was the Beatles. You know, that's the first band I ever bought any of their records or any. They suck.
I hate the Beatles.
How could you hate the Beatles?
Because they, I don't know. The same thing with like Led Zeppelin and stuff. All them people think that you can just like smoke a whole bunch of drugs and you get a higher meaning from it.
The later Beatles music, like there was stuff, everything from Sgt. Pepper on, like really, you know, remember being, you know, 5 years old and my dad's 280 orange Datsun 280ZX driving at 6 a.m. to go to softball games and listen to the Beatles. And I guess there's a lot of really memorable moments from my life that involve Beatles songs, you know, and like a song, the song A Day in the Life is like, you know, my favorites. I think it's one of the best songs ever written. I mean, I'm not a big Led Zeppelin fan, but you know, there are certain things that they did that you can still hear in heavy music. The way John Bonham plays drums, Rat wouldn't be around if that guy didn't play drums, because they lifted every beat they could off that guy. And but I mean, the way stuff I listened to, like, you know, like first concert I went to, I saw Metallica when I was 9 years old and Ozzy Osbourne. My uncle took me to see that because his friend got all drunk and couldn't go because he passed out. And you know, like Def Leppard.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah, man. For Fooling.
Uh-huh. Back before they became a girl band.
Yep.
They sing love songs all the time.
The big British flag t-shirts.
Photograph. Yeah. One-arm drummers and all. Anyways.
No, I listen like Radiohead.
You like Radiohead?
I love Radiohead. I don't really listen to a lot of heavy music just because none of it's really challenging anymore, I don't think. A lot of it, I mean, the best period for metal was the late 80s, early 90s, and the reason why is because most of the people playing the music were really, really talented. You're not going to find a Dimebag Darrell guitar player anymore that can drink a fifth of Jack Daniels, go on stage, more plastered than humanly possible, and sit there and play flawlessly, you know. And with, I mean, now it's like, you know, I used to ride a skateboard, I wear real big baggy pants and some makeup, and I'm a rock star, you know.
So what do you think like Marilyn Manson and Korn and that type of stuff that's out now?
Well, Marilyn Manson, his genius lies in his marketing ability. You know, I mean, first Marilyn Manson album was really good, I think, musically. You know,
which one is that?
Portrait of American Family. Yeah. I could care. Antichrist Superstar sounds like a bad Nine Inch Nails record to me. You know, and this new one's like a bad David Bowie album. But the first one, no one sounded like that, and his lyrics were fucking awesome. Like shit that he was writing back then, and he sang good. Now it's kind of like, dude, you got too lost in being cool. You know, Korn, I'm really think it's great what they're doing for heavy music. You know, I do not think they're one of the most talented bands to get as big as they are. And, you know, I think, you know, it kind of upsets me. I grew up, when I think of Adidas, I think of Run DMC, when I think of the Beastie Boys, and not Korn. And I mean, I think what Korn's doing for heavy music is really, really good. Thought the first album was real groundbreaking, but as for the rest of it goes...
Yeah, we had a big conversation about that.
Mm-hmm. I said the exact same thing on the way down.
I still like him, so fuck all you. So, big question is, your mom ever catch you masturbating?
Dude, I can come up with at least 6 or 7 different instances. When I'll go into detail.
Okay. Well, so the next question, what's... Okay, go ahead.
Let's hear about your penis.
You don't have to hear about my penis. The first time I got caught, like the way I used to set out things, I was first learning to masturbate. So I'd go on the end of my bed, and I'd usually be on my knees. And man, my mom and dad walked in my room like 3 or 4 times bringing laundry in. Jesus. It's always like dick in hand looking right at them, you know?
It's like just washing it.
No,
just
I think...
cleaning it.
I think probably the one thing that my mom never wished she walked in on was the first time I was fucking a girl in the ass. She walked in, and I mean, you know, girls on our hands and knees with my dick up her butt, and you know, like, that's all you can see when you walk in the door, was both of our asses and my balls.
You know? Nothing better than a good ass fucking story, I suppose. Everybody likes that. So, what's the best place you ever played? What's your favorite place to go? What's your favorite city?
My venue? Favorite club to play is the 930 Club in D.C. It's the most beautiful club ever built. My favorite crowd to play in front of? I don't know. Really, to tell you the truth, anywhere where we have a lot of our fans come out, all those shows usually seem to be real similar.
Have you ever played here in Minnesota before?
Actually, no. This is my first time.
I'd like to know what your opinion is on Minnesotans, because I want to know also, every time you go to a different city, you always tell them that they're the best concert. I that's one thing I always have wondered. You know, you see a band and they're like, you're the best crowd we've ever had, you know, and then they go to the next city and you're the best crowd we ever had.
See, I know kids follow some of our shows, so I ain't that stupid. You know? We're not one of those type of bands that really goes out there with a plan setting of what we're going to do. It's just, we write what song, what order we want to play our songs in, and whatever happens in between there is, I mean, we have songs, we'll just, in the middle of the song, just start playing whatever. It has nothing to do with the song. Just, you know, because that's mainly what we do in band practice. What we do is sit there and jam and make up mellow shit.
You guys do any covers?
We mess around with them, but we never gotten one to the point where we figure we can play live in front of people. Like, we do Rain and Blood great.
Kick ass.
But I always mess up the words. Like, I cannot seemingly remember the vocal melody of the song. You know, I do not know why. And if I could get that, then I'd play that constantly. It's So Easy by Guns N' Roses. Mm-hmm. That's fun to play.
Yeah.
So.
Wow, what's some of the craziest shit that's happened while you're up there on stage? See some titties hanging out and shit?
I've watched a girl get completely stripped naked before. Poor girl.
You didn't fuck her in the ass, did you?
No.
Oh, okay.
I couldn't get my dick out in time to jump on her on that point. But no, she's just crowd surfing, and the crowd did not seem to feel a need to let her get down, and they tore off every piece of clothing on her body.
Yeah, that's
I tried to help her, you know. But I took my hand, I tried to grab her hand, pull her on stage. And the bouncer was just standing there not doing anything. I couldn't, that was in Providence, Rhode Island. We were playing with Kilgore, as a matter of fact, when that happened.
All right, well, let's take a break here. We're going to check out, what do you want to see? Defaced? That's what it's really.
Sure, why not?
All right, we're going to watch that video and we'll be back in a little bit.
I'm ready to go.
I just asked that question. All right. So we're back, and I'm still with What's-His-Face from What's-His-Name. Oh, it's Matt from Nothingface.
I'm so respected here.
Hey. All right, so you already asked all these damn questions. How about, what's the truth with groupies and getting sex?
What's the truth?
Yeah, do you ever get laid by people out there?
Yeah.
Can I have some?
Sure, man. I mean, sometimes it's really easy, sometimes it's not, but it happens a lot. And any musician that tells you he doesn't indulge is usually a liar. Actually, wait, that's not true, because my drummer and bass player do not cheat on their wives at all. I can honestly say that.
That's what I said.
They do not, you know, and me, on the other hand, I do not have a girlfriend, so
aw, it's on. Aw, man, you're so cute and everything.
Not good.
I'm, oh man.
You're all nervous.
I don't know. There you go. I'm thinking about that getting fucked in the ass thing. It's making me nervous, man.
I got Vaseline in my backpack.
Yeah.
If you really want to use that camera for some good.
Yeah. You know. So we're going to check out a video.
My name then.
What's my name?
Bitch. Oh, Matt. So what? I already kind of asked you this, but who you listen to now again?
You know, Radiohead, Faith No More is probably the two main bands that I listen to more than anything.
I'm out of questions to ask you. So, good. We're going to check out another video because I don't remember what I was going to ask you anymore. But thanks for my little bit of time that you let me have and sit here with you. And we'll have Paul back.
Yeah, I'll be right back.
Bye.
Hey, you got to get into it.
Yeah, you got to. Maybe
you
could
look
at him every now and then. Yeah. Show him a little love, you know, something.
He
showed me a lot
too much.
See,
Paul
knows
how to get into it.
Yeah.
All right.
I only got two more questions. So.
Okay. All right, hey, what's up? We're back with Matt
I remember the name from Nothingface. What kind of advice could you give to our viewers who are like starting out in bands right now themselves? Any like words of encouragement or anything you could give them?
Well, the first thing I think a lot of bands got to realize is what happens in your local scene does not mean a thing. You know, it only matters nationally. So every band out there that's trying to start out, the most simple thing you can do, go to Borders Books or any bookstore like that, buy the American Musicians Touring Guide. It's a listing of every club in the whole country, and some of them you can get the whole world. And they will have a listing of exactly what kind of clubs, that what kind of music they book in those clubs, and all the contact number and everything. You have to go and play the worst shows you possibly can for as long as you can take it, so that way club owners get to know you and are willing to put you on the better shows. Go play in New York as much as you can, you know, because this is closer to New York than LA, you know, and just get your name. You'd be surprised how quickly, like, all the club owners talk and all the booking agents talk, and if you come through town, you play a shitty little club in so-and-so, you know, Bumblefuck, Ohio, you know, and that club owner remembers you. Say when Fear Factory comes through next and they don't have an opener, they might call you up, or, you know, and that's the way we did it. We played 3 local shows and went on the road and just, you know, killing ourselves. And that's what we've been doing ever since.
Okay. If someone came up to you and said, you know, who are you, you know, what do you sound like, or like, you know, why should I buy your shit, what would you tell them?
Really, there's not much you can really say to make people buy shit. I'd just basically be like, we're good. You know, I mean, confidence is really everything, and I mean, I don't mean to sound too conceited, but I am a little bit, and I arrogance is one of the wonderful things that comes along with being in a band. Mm-hmm. But to buy my record, to tell you, we're heavier than most bands around right now. I think that our music's way more extreme, and I think we have way more melody than a lot of other bands. So, you know, if you want to listen to a metal band that's almost a cross between Pantera and Foo Fighters, I guess, at times, then we're it.
Okay. All right. Well, for my final question, how do you think the metal scene will be in the future, and, you know, like, what bands do you see rising to the top, and where would you like to see you guys in the future, in that scene, hopefully?
Well, actually, I hope we're kind of in our own scene, you know, like, think bands like Tool and Pantera I really, really respect, because when you think of Tool, when you think of Pantera, you don't think other bands. When you think of Limp Bizkit, you think of Korn. When you think of, I mean, I hate to do this to the Deftones, because they're, I think, one of the best bands to come out in the past 10 years. But unfortunately, they came up in that crew, and they were put in that. But when people think of the Deftones, they think of Korn. People think of Cold Chamber, they think of Korn. People think of Korn, they think of Cold Chamber, Limp Bizkit, Deftones, and everyone else. You know, and even Orgy, they sound nothing like them. But everyone knows they came from Korn's crew.
Right.
You know, I don't want to be associated with any of that. What I see in the future, unfortunately, is 80s music coming back. You know, there could be a lot more Flock of Seagulls and crap like that. So everyone, get ready for big hair and bad makeup once again. And I want Nothingface to be in our own little world. I want us to be, hopefully, one of the biggest metal bands in the world, and just Nothingface, you know.
Okay, cool. Have you guys got overseas by chance? I was just curious.
No, only, and the reason why is because European licensing is a really weird thing. It's really easy to get sucked into a deal where you get screwed, you know. And what we want to do is, a lot of other bands will sign a record deal for the world, you know, with. What we like to do is have a record deal for each continent, which is very, very possible, and probably, in our opinion, the smartest thing to do. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're waiting a little while till we get a little bit more credibility in the U.S., because we don't want to be a band that Nothingface is huge in Europe. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to be huge everywhere, yeah. You know, and I want to start with the U.S., and you know, I don't know, you know, it's not that I wouldn't get any satisfaction out of being a bigger band in Europe, but there's something, it's like the minor leagues to me, you know, and I want to be big in the U.S. first, and that's what we're concentrating on.
That's cool. Well, I wish you the best of luck. Thanks
thank
a lot for being
much.
Here, Matt.
No,
all
thank
right?
you guys very
And we're
going
to have you have your address up on the screen, so the people that can't find the shit here in the stores can at least go to D-Side and get it. So
cool.
Thanks again, man.
Well, thank you.
All right, thanks
thank
a lot.
You
yeah.
Much.
What is it,
yeah.
killer27.com?
killer27.com. Also, if you want to look for something real funny, some girl put up a website, it's called In Lust of Nothing Face, and she's offering her panties for pictures. So, if you find
a
picture, of us or anything else like that, and you want some panties, cool. And look at our guest book, and they have all the information's in there. Huh?
The screen always freezes up when you go to that guest book.
That's probably just that computer.
Oh, really? Well, that doesn't freeze up for me.
You're retarded. All right. Cool. All right. Thanks again. Check us out on the next episode.
All right.
Thanks, man.
Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it.
Do you want another smoke?
Yeah.
Sure. Oh, yeah. Can you do a station ID?
I sure can.
All right. The Dark Hour is the name of the show. Also, we need another one for High Voltage.
Okay.
They're on our same station. He was upstairs doing Mojo. He actually borrowed us a fucking tape because I forgot one.
High Voltage?
Yeah, High Voltage. And then I'll tell you some other ones later. There's a couple of radio. Burton sent me a whole bunch of radio shit.
Mm-hmm.
So just say, like, hi, my name's Matt. You're watching, or you're from Nothingface. You're watching The Dark Hour.
Okay. I didn't know if you wanted me to add your names in or anything.
These two dickheads from the dark.
Okay. All right, do you want me to go now? Hey, this is Matt from Nothingface, and you're watching two dickheads on the Dark Hour. How was that?
Dark Hour.
All right, and then the other show is High Voltage.
Still two more dickheads?
Tommy the Dickhead, no, it's Tommy Danger, or, you know, that's his name, Tommy Danger, High Voltage, or whatever.
No, I'll just do the generic one.
Yeah, all right.
Hi, this is Matt from Nothingface, and you're watching High Voltage.
All right, now what's that one, 93X, the radio station here, and also 100, I've been playing you guys this shit now. Finally,
yeah.
So, you wanted to get one for 93?
Yeah, I've been talking to her, and she's been asking information about you. I've been getting close for your shit on the radio.
So her name is, what is it, Ton?
Mastery. Just say, like, Ton.
Ton?
T-A-W-N.
Yeah.
Ton.
Or T-A-W-N, is that right?
It's probably like T-A-W-N.
Or whatever.
Like, Ton.
Yeah.
Ton.
Shit.
I didn't
say, hi, you're listening to the, hey, this is Matt from Nothingface, and you're listening to the biggest jokes on radio, Ton Mastery. I'm 93.
I'm listening to the biggest joke, what?
Biggest jugs on the radio.
You want me? You really want me to say that? I mean, she's not gonna be offended if I'm talking about our tits. And you're watching the biggest joke on the radio.
Okay.
Yeah, this is gonna go. This is gonna be an 93X. Let me just get this right. Okay. This is Matt from Nothingface, and you're listening to the largest drugs. Sorry. You know anything? Uggs. You know I have to put the D in it. This is Matt from Nothingface, and you're listening to the largest jugs in radio. 93X. Oh yeah.
Cool. Thanks a lot, man.
Thank you, guys.
I'm looking forward to seeing you guys finally. You know, I was plugging Burton, like, you know, right away. I'm like, dude, when are they going to come? And then he finally, like, sent me this thing highlighted in big red. He's like, finally, Minnesota. So,
it's cool. My throat's all fucked up, so I'm not going to sound right tonight.
That's all right. It's
yeah,
cool.
I'm smoking away. It, you know,
drink more tea.
Yeah, I haven't. I wouldn't even smoke cigarettes, but I've been like this all day. I haven't been smoking any cigarettes.
Yeah.
No one in my band will give me one.
Like, you know, I'm
at this point, I'm going to be all...
Do you have cigarettes?
Yeah. So they don't know I'm smoking. So by the time they see this, they'll forget that my throat hurts.
You listen to feedback,
No.
No.
Yeah. Does anyone figure out what this is yet?
Is that a chastity?
Yeah,
chastity.
Like,
that's weird. Chastity. Yeah, we're like...
Okay, what do you think these people on the cover are? I've been asking people.
Refugees from some of them, or a bomb or some shit.
No.
Or nurses.
So,
you want to see something real funny? Look at all the, okay, look. There's